The following program is a work of fiction. Browningate is not an actual officer of the law, and this video should not be taken to imply that he is. All musical sequences are covered under fair use where appropriate. Enjoy the show. Date is April 29th, 2024. This is Detective Browningate of the YouTube Police Department. I've been told that I can't leave until I solve one of the internet's oldest cold cases. For this one, we're going to reach back almost 50 years. There's not too much to go off of here looking at the case file. All the witnesses are dead. The building is gone. There's no forensic evidence. There are no biological samples. Even if there were, I suspect somebody would have coughed on them by now, rendering them gross and useless. In fact, the only evidence we have at all is this old record. So, just to refresh my memory, I'm going to go ahead and put it in and give it a listen. Opening segment here. This is visualized almost perfectly by that telling scene in the 1999 movie The 13th Floor, where the man gets out of the car after he's been driving down that dark desert highway and is able to see where the fully rendered world ends and where it becomes just a wireframe. Now, you don't see the Cletus. You can't actually... Actually, you can. You can basically smell the Axe body spray just pouring up out of the ground like dew on a lake. I don't know if he's wearing the body spray. It seems like he's really going into the land of fruits and nuts. He's experiencing basically a sunset and a sunrise at the same time. You can tell it's a song of delirium and drowsiness. And at this point, you know, he's like any of us. You know, he gets tired. He is definitely looking for a hotel. And what better place to stay in California when you're looking for a hotel than Hotel California? Like many modern pop songs, this has the obligatory, sappy, romantic aspect baked in, but beyond that, it has some historical significance as well. I didn't even know this the first time I heard it. I guess I just kind of assumed it as a fact, but Wikipedia backs me up here. In that line about the Mission Bell, it says here, Mission Foods was founded as a subsidiary of Grupo Maseca, now Gruma, in California, in 1977. So you may not have known it, but the product and the song complement each other with an unprecedented level of historical accuracy. So in this way, I applaud Kent for his keen awareness. What I don't applaud him for, but at the same time, what I can't fault him for is not recognizing the red flag of a Tiffany. Now, what we have that Kent did not have decades ago was the Universal Hot Crazy Matrix, which of course warns us of the dangers of Tiffany's.
Above the crazy line, we have the danger zone. This is your redheads, your strippers, anyone named Tiffany.
Hairdressers.
This is hairdressers. This is where your car gets keyed, you get a bunny in the pot, your tires get slashed, and you wind up in jail.
So this person standing in the doorway is literally checking off two of the boxes right there in the danger zone on the Universal Hot Crazy Matrix. Not a good place to be in. And perhaps the fatal decision that led to Kent's ultimate downfall. There isn't too much to say here. This section really is pretty self-explanatory, so I'm not going to dwell on it for too long. This is basically an expression of the passage of time, and also maybe an orgy, or orgies. And the point of this section, I think, is to show that he went further than he wanted to go, and he stayed much longer than he wanted to stay. He's probably missed whatever appointment or spectacle that he wanted to see in California. And he's basically throwing his life away here in the hotel. But as you'll see in the next section, he is finally starting to wake up to the fact that it's probably time to quit wasting money, spending unnecessary nights in hotels, to move forward with his life and go home. I mean, you can practically hear the hotel clerk's surprise through the song. I mean, the guy, he basically falls out of his seat upon hearing this request, because nobody in 20-some years since Hotel California was apparently established has called to the front desk to ask a question like this. It's just unprecedented at this point by Hotel California standards.
Chambers, they're gathered for the feast. They stab it with their stealing eyes, but they just can't kill the beast.
Now, I think in this sequence, Kent gets a little bit more than he bargained for in that dining room. To start out with, let's talk about the dimensions of the dining room. I want to say that the executive dining hall here is probably, I've always pictured it as a narrower room, not a particularly large room like the one in the Dilbert story. I think it's at that point, even though it's kind of been building up here throughout the course of these days or possibly weeks in this story, when he finally realizes that Hotel California is officially nuts. I mean, what they have here, if you're interpreting the song literally like I am, and the way that I think the artist intends for it to be interpreted, they have literally brought some wild beast, either a, I don't know if it's a bull or a dog or a bulldog or whatever the hell they have in there, but you have this live animal in there, and it is running around the dining hall, and they've made a game out of stabbing it, which, when you think about what they're describing here, it's a very disturbing picture. But it's also a very fascinating one. And I think that this is the culminating moment. This is the climax of the song, even though it's in basically the last line of it. You know, that you never really know where it's going until you get to this point. And you picture this moment. You see Kent, you're looking through his eyes, he's looking around the room, he's seeing an animal running around on the table and or possibly on the floor, and all these people running around trying to stab it or whatever. That is the moment when it clicks for him, when he realizes that this is not a place you want to be. This is like worse than haunted. This is practically an asylum.
Kill the beast. Last thing I remember, I was running for the door.
I truly do wish that I had a better report to deliver to Kent's family, but unfortunately the conclusion that I am forced to arrive at is that he was killed, his body was cut up into many pieces, and there is no trace left. Tiffany is long gone, probably went on to kill many other people just like Kent, and there's really not a happy ending to this story. This has been Detective Browningate signing off. You're welcome.
Thank you.